You see Leah up here preaching the word. Thank you so much, sis, for sharing your heart, for sharing your convictions, for sharing your life. And then we had Chris K up here sharing his convictions. The young prophet of God. Look forward to seeing him preach one Sunday.
Come on.
I just want to thank you guys for being here today. Also want to just give a shout out to our sister, Panyin, from New York. She's here with us for a week. 2 weeks? No, 1 week. So please wrap your arms around our sister, amen? Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for today. I pray that you speak powerfully through me to your people. Move me aside and just show your people what they need. We thank you. We love you. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. A man named John Ruskin, he's a British author.
Come on.
He said, "We were not sent into this world to do anything which we cannot put our hearts into." Another author said, "If we fall, we don't need to be self-crimination or blame or anger. We need a reawakening of our intention and willingness to recommit to be wholehearted once again." Another man said, "Wherever you go, go with all of your heart." The title of the lesson today is Wholehearted Devotion. Do you have a wholehearted devotion this morning? I looked at the word whole. It means all up, entire. Hearted is part of your heart to give everything, and devotion is love, loyalty, enthusiasm for a person or activity. And I see that God wants our whole hearts. God wants us to be wholehearted. He wants us to give him a wholehearted devotion. God wants us to love him with all of our hearts, to be loyal to him with all of our hearts, to be enthusiastic for him with all of our hearts. Are you with me, church? God wants a wholehearted devotion. Let's go to 2 Chronicles chapter 25. And we're going to look at a king named Amaziah. So he is king of Judah. At this time, Israel is divided, or the Israelites are divided into two kingdoms, Israel and Judah. Now the kingdom of Judah has two tribes, Judah and Benjamin. And the other 10 tribes are in the tribe of Israel. We start in verse 1, 2 Chronicles chapter 25, verse 1. Amaziah was 25 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem for 29 years. His mother's name was Jehoshaphat. She was from Jerusalem. So we got Amaziah 25 years old, and he becomes king. That you could do great things at a young age. That you could do great things at the age of 25. You can do great things at the age of 35. 45. 55. 65. You can do great things at the age of 15. Verse 2. It said, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. I mean, this guy was cranking. This guy was having his quiet times. This guy was sharing his faith. This guy was praying. Everyone saw him as doing good in the eyes of the Lord. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, but not wholehearted. Woo! That is scary. You got this brother having quiet times, praying, always sharing his faith. He's on time. He preaches the word, but he does not give all of his heart. they highlight this in the Bible. I gotta ask you today, are you giving your whole heart?
Yep.
Are you giving your whole heart to everyone? You know, as I give my whole heart to you guys gotta give me your whole hearts as well. So if I'm fired up and you're not fired up, you're not giving me your heart. Are you with me, church? So can we be fired up today? Amen. Are you fired up for one another? Do you give your whole heart to one another? Do you give your whole heart to the kingdom? Do you give your whole heart to God? Do you give your whole heart to your leaders? You know, giving your whole heart to your leaders will demonstrate you giving your whole heart to God.
Right.
See, you can't give your whole heart to God if you're not giving your whole heart to your leaders.
Yeah.
And you can't give your whole heart to your leaders if you're not giving your whole heart to God. I just gotta be honest. At the beginning, we're a church. The East Region, we do what is right in the eyes of God.
Amen.
That is awesome. We got some cranking disciples in the East Region. We got some amazing disciples in the East Region. But I don't think we always give our whole hearts. You may have your quiet time. You may pray. You may share. You may come to. You may do what's right. You may be compliant. You obey. But you're not in full obedience because you're not giving your whole heart. When you're giving your whole heart, that's when you're fully obedient.
Yeah, amen.
But when you give half of your heart, you end up being half obedient, which actually equals full disobedience. Are you giving your whole heart? What are you not giving your whole heart to? Maybe it's in your relationships. In your dating relationships. Maybe it's in your marriage. Are you giving your whole heart? Are you giving your whole heart to the person that God has put in your life? Or have you backed away? Have you said, I don't want to be hurt, so I'll comply. I'll be there. I'll give you the right answers. I'll do the right thing, but I'm not going to give you everything because I don't want to be hurt. Because I see the commitment. I don't know if I can commit. I'll do it, but I don't know if I can commit long term. And you end up not giving your whole heart. Point number one. A lukewarm heart. A lukewarm heart. The body has a specific temperature, which is called a core temperature. Do you guys know what that is?
Yeah.
What degree? 37 degrees in Celsius. Which is about 98 degrees Fahrenheit, I believe. For the Americans. Maybe. Okay, amen. This is about 37 degrees Celsius. Now, okay, for the heart to work, for the heart to give 100%, for the heart to be wholehearted, the body has to be at 37 degrees Celsius to give its whole heart. There's a symptom called, or a disease called hypothermia, which means the body core decreases in Celsius. So hypothermia is when the body goes down to 35 degrees Celsius. Now, is that freezing?
No.
No, but it's lukewarm.
Oh.
You can be lukewarm in your discipleship. You may have hypothermia right now in your Christian life. The first stage of hypothermia is shivering. You get a bit, you're not freezing, but you get a bit cold. You're like, man, this is a bit, you get a bit chilly in your walk with God. Also, confusion. You get confused and you think, well, do I really have to be a disciple? Bible in order to be saved? Can I get baptized and then become a disciple? That's not what the Bible teaches. No. Does it matter if I don't go to church every Sunday? Does it matter if I go to another church? Well, if it doesn't teach what the Bible teaches, yes, it matters. The second stage, shivering stops. You get in denial. You don't think you're lukewarm anymore. You don't think you're cold, but you are cold. You're 35 degrees Celsius. And confusion increases. Oh, well, it's okay that I missed the quiet time. It's okay that I didn't pray. God sees my heart. I know I missed a day, but I'm here. I want to study the Bible. I want to give God everything. I'm here, right? And in the third stage, the victim starts removing their clothes. You know, Ephesians 6 speaks about the full armor of God. You start taking off the armor of God. You stop having your quiet times completely. You stop reading your Bible completely. You stop praying completely. You stop coming to church completely. And you're at the risk of your heart stopping. You're at the risk of dying spiritually. Of your spiritual life coming to a complete halt. And that's what lukewarm is. That's what lukewarm will do to you. Verse 3. After the kingdom was firmly in his control, he executed the officials who had murdered his father, the king. Yet he did not put their children to death, but acted in accordance with what is written in the law, in the book of Moses, where the Lord commanded, parents shall not be put to death for their children, nor children be put to death for their parents. Each will die for their own sin. That's pretty noble of Amaziah. Yeah. He goes and he kills those who killed his father, and he's like, you know what? These children, I'm not going to put these children. They're going to live because it's not their fault that their fathers and mothers have sinned. So he kept the children alive. That's awesome. All right. This is a cool guy. Verse 5. And Messiah called the people of Judah together and assigned them according to their families to commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds for all Judah and Benjamin. He then mustered those 20-year-olds or more and found that there were 300,000 men fit for military service, able to handle the spear and shield. We see Amaziah, he went after the young people. Amen. This is why we go after the young people, because the young people can do great things to God. Amen. The young people are the game changers in this world. Amen. The young people are who are going to go out and evangelize the world. Amen? Amen. Verse 6. He also hired 100,000 fighting men from Israel for 100 talents of silver. Now remember, the kingdom is divided. So Amaziah, he's the king of Judah, and he gets all the fighting men of Judah, and they're ready to fight. He got the 20-year-olds, he got the guys who are fit, ready to serve, ready to fight. And he's thinking, let me see if they can spare any men up north. So he goes to the kingdom of Israel, and he gets 100,000 fighting men from another kingdom. Verse 7. But the man of God came to him and said, Your Majesty, these troops from Israel must not march with you, for the Lord is not with Israel, not with any of the people of Ephraim. We'll stop there. This is very important to understand. When David was king, the kingdom was united. All 12 tribes were together. They were the Israelites. They were God's chosen people. Yeah. Now the kingdom has divided. 10 tribes in the north, 2 in the south. And the scripture says that the Lord God is not with the kingdom in the north. It's not with the church in the north. It's not with the 10 tribes, you know. Even though they're Israelites, even though they were designed to be God's chosen people, God was in the southern kingdom. And the man of God came to his life like, bro, he got rebuked for going to a church where God is not there. He got rebuked for mingling with people when God is not with them. And he said, they can't go. They can't go into war with you. Verse 8. The man of God said, even if you go and fight courageously in battle, God will overthrow you before the enemy. For God has the power to help or to overthrow. Amaziah asked the man of God, but what about the 100 talents I paid for these Israelite troops? What about all the effort, all the time that I put in to do something that is against God's command? What about all the energy I put in to do something that you don't want me to do? I don't know if you got called to maybe change your career in life. I don't know, maybe you got called to go to university. Maybe you got called to change something in your life that you've been working on for years. And you're like, whoa, wait, what about the hard effort? What about the time? What about the money? What about the energy? Do I really have to give it up? Do I really have to do this? Do I really have to do that? And that's where he was like, what about the money? That's a lot of money. The man of God replied, the Lord can give you much more than that. The Lord can give you much more. I think in this country, we worry about money a lot. Even as disciples, we can worry about money. And what we have to realize is that when we put our whole, when we're wholeheartedly, when we give a wholehearted devotion to God, money is the last thing that we have to think about. Yeah, you got to make money. Money is important. You got to pay bills and buy food, amen? But God can give you way more. I don't know if you believe that, church. Like, God can give you more. Verse 10. So Amaziah dismissed the troops who had came to him from Ephraim and sent them home. They were furious with Judah and left for home in a great rage. Amaziah, he obeyed, he listened to discipling, and he submitted to the man of God. Amen? I hope you do the same as well. And we see that Amaziah was like, okay, guys, I know I brought you guys down here to the church. I know I said you guys were going to go out to battle and do great things together, but God is not with you guys. I got to send you back. And they got ticked off. They probably got ticked off at the fact that it was mentioned that God wasn't with them. Yeah. That's probably what they got ticked off at. Hey, God isn't with you. The man of God told me. And the man of God speaks directly from God. Yeah. Verse 11. Amaziah then marshaled his strength and led his army to the valley of Saul, where he killed 10,000 men of Seir. The army of Judah also captured 10,000 men alive, took them to the top of the cliff, and drew them down so that all were dashed to pieces. Like, Amaziah went and totally destroyed the enemy. Verse 13. Meanwhile, the troops that Amaziah had sent back had not allowed to take part in the war raid. Meanwhile, the troops that Amaziah had sent back and had not allowed to take part in the war raided towns belonging to Judah, from Samaria to Beth Horon. That these guys who were first hired and then they were fired attacked the towns of Judah, attacked the kingdom that God was with, pulling people, taking people from the church, killing people, hurting people's faith. That's what they did. Yeah. It also said that they killed 3,000 people and carried off great quantities of plunder. Verse 14. When Amaziah returned from slaughtering the Edomites, he brought back the gods of the people of Seir. He set them up as his own gods, bowed down to them, and burnt sacrifices to them. What is going on? And the sign was giving, he was doing what was right in the eyes of God. He got discipling from the man of God. The man of God said, hey, bro, you have to do this, and you have to do that. And he obeyed. He was in compliance. But then God gave him victory. And he forgot God. He didn't see that the victory came from God. Why? Because he was not giving his whole heart. See, we can be deceived what giving our whole heart means. It's not mean just doing what's right in the eyes of God. It's giving everything that you have to the things that you are doing. Giving everything that you have to one another. Giving everything that you got to the kingdom of God. And not holding back. We just hold back too much. We hold back our feelings. We hold back our thinking. We hold back our actions. He held back his heart. He held back his thinking. He held back the thoughts that he had. And he took the gods of the enemy that he just defeated, brought him back, set them up, and started worshiping. And I'm like, there are the idols in my life that I've started to worship. I may be doing what's right in the eyes of God, but are there any idols in my life? What are the idols in our lives? Maybe it's your phone. Maybe it's Facebook. That's on your phone. Maybe it's Instagram, Twitter. Maybe it's a relationship. Maybe it's our wives, our husband. Maybe it's the things, the desires that are in the world. Oh, I don't have that in the kingdom. Because it's not right in the eyes of God. Oh, I want that in the kingdom. Do it the righteous way. The desires. I think Amaziah had some desires. And he didn't get open about. And some that weren't being fulfilled. He started worshiping others. He set up the gods of the enemy. And I was like, wow. A lukewarm heart will cause lukewarm convictions. And that's my second point. Lukewarm convictions. Verse 15. The anger of the Lord burned against Amaziah, and he sent a prophet to him who said, why do you consult this people? The people's gods, which could not save their own people from your hand. He's like, are you crazy? Are you dumb? Their gods couldn't even help them. Why are you worshiping them? Pornography, masturbation, it didn't save your life. Jesus Christ saved your life. Yes. No relationship in the world saved your life. Jesus Christ saved your life. Yeah. No job in the world had saved your life. Jesus Christ saved your life. Don't forget that Christ saved you. Don't forget what Christ has done for you. Don't forget what the Bible teaches. What the Bible says. The Bible says that if you hold to my teachings, then you are really my disciples, then you'll know the truth, and then you'll be set free. Amaziah was not holding on to the teachings with his whole heart. Verse 15 again. The anger of the Lord burned against Amaziah, and he sent a prophet to him, who said, why do you consult this people's gods, which could not save their own people from your hand? While he was speaking, the king said, have we appointed you and an advisor to the king? Stop! Why be struck down? So the prophet stopped, but said, I know that God has determined to destroy you, because you have done this and have not listened to my counsel. Wow. Amaziah had lukewarm convictions. He simply did not believe in disciples. It's not that he didn't believe, he stopped believing in the sign. That's even scary from not believing. Once believing, to not believing. I believe. He took the advice of the man of God. He might not have liked it, but he took the advice. And then God sent a prophet to speak to this king. And he's ready to strike this prophet dead. He stopped believing in this. Before I am a preacher, before I am a speaker, before I am a region leader, I am a disciple.
Come on.
Before anyone is a leader, we are disciples.
Yes.
And if you want to be a disciple, you've got to give your whole heart, amen? And as disciples, we believe it's a command by God to be a disciple in relationships. Matthew 28. 20. You know, I'm so encouraged by two brothers, by Chris K and Jermaine. And last week, you know, they spoke to me and it was like, bro, can I show you something? And I was like, yeah, cool, awesome. I didn't know what they wanted to speak to me about, tell me. And they was like, oh, bro, I think you said the wrong word in your sermon. I was like, yeah, I saw that. But thank you for speaking to me. Basically, there was a scripture in the Bible, I said curse, and it's actually a course, but I said curse. I still believe if a man doesn't lead his wife, he will definitely be cursed, but the scripture didn't say curse right there, so I apologize to the church, amen, and I received that discipleship. Thank you, brothers, for helping me out right there. And I say, hey, we're disciples. Disciples disciple each other.
Amen.
Anytime you're in a church and there's no discipling, that is not the kingdom of God.
Great. Come on.
Anytime that you are in a congregation and half of the church believes in discipling and the other half doesn't, that is not the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
We are not an autonomous church.
Amen.
We are a universal church. Amen?
Amen.
This is why we're having the first principles. Amen.
Yes.
This is like a 3 to 6 week course on what it means to be totally devoted to God.
Yeah.
And what it means to be a Christian. What it means to be a disciple.
Uh-huh.
And it unifies us because what we teach is the same thing that we teach everywhere in every church.
Yeah.
And we see that Amaziah just stopped believing in discipling. Have you stopped believing in discipling? What is discipling? When you listen, obey, you give your whole heart to that man or woman that God has put into your life. See, you don't actually have to be a disciple to get discipled. Don't confuse yourself. You don't have to be a disciple to be discipled. Right? The world can disciple. The world can teach, correct, and rebuke you. Not for every good work, but for some good works. I believe other religions can teach, correct, train, and rebuke you. Not for every good work, but for some good works. But we know that the word of God is useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training for every good work. Are you with me? So if it's useful for every good work, you gotta allow the brothers and sisters, the men and women, to train you with the word of God, to teach you with the word of God, to correct you with the word of God, to rebuke you with the word of God. Right?
Yes.
Anyone can be discipled by the word of God.
Yep.
But it's true of disciples that accept discipling relationships. Do you have a discipling relationship? I pray that you do. When was the last time you had D-time? When was the last time you got together with that man or woman of God that is in your life?
Yes.
And you just got open, you just spoke about things, you just worked on your life. Was it a couple months ago? Are you in a discipling relationship if it was a couple months ago? Maybe you never had this.
Yeah.
Well, maybe it's because you're not a disciple. Maybe you want this. That's awesome. Study the Bible.
Yes.
And we see just Amaziah just stop believing in discipling. Go to verse 17. It says, after Amaziah, king of Judah, consulted his advisors, he sent this challenge to Jehoash, son of Jehoahaz, the son of Judah, king of Israel. Come, let us face each other in battle. You notice Amaziah did not speak to God at all. He did not inquire of the Lord. He did not pray at all. Even though God sent men of God, sent a prophet to him, he didn't go to God. And you know what he did? He consulted with his own advisors. Maybe you have your own advisors. Maybe your family is your own advisors. Maybe the church that you went to previously are your own advisors. Maybe your friends who maybe go to church, but you know they're not living the life that God calls them to live, are your own advisors. And you allow your advisors to tell you what you want to hear instead of letting the word of God tell you what you need to hear. That's what we do. Our discipler says, okay, bro, you need to leave your job and get a better job.
Yeah.
Woo! That's tough. Okay, bro. So you're being compliant, you're obeying. Okay, bro. You call another brother in another region. Bro. I had this time with my disciple. Who's your disciple though? Sean! And he's like, I gotta leave my job. Oh, bro, that's I know it's tough. Oh, man. Oh, he's being a bit harsh, bro. Oh, I know he's being a bit harsh. Oh, what are you going to do, bro? I don't know. Oh, bro. I'm praying. And you might speak to someone about that. I've done that. Whatever it is. I've done that. I've done discipling, and I'm just like, okay, I'll do it. And then I'll call some brothers up, bro, guess what happened to me? Guess what happened to me at D-Talk? Guess what happened to me when I was with the man of God in my life? He challenged me. Bro, I don't like challenges. This is why I'm calling you. We don't like challenges. And when we get challenged, we look for different advice. Bro, let me speak to someone that will give me an easier challenge. Let me speak to someone that knows what I want. That knows what will be easier for me. Yeah. Right? Yeah. And then we usually go to other people, other leaders, instead of the man or woman that God has put in our lives. And I just saw Amaziah, he went, and the tribe of Israel picked a fight with Judah by raiding their camp. But Amaziah was like, I'm going to go after them. Didn't listen to the prophet. Didn't go to God. He was just like, let's face each other. Let's fight, right? And as a church, we don't want to fight other people. We don't want to fight other churches. We want to let the scriptures to do all the fighting. And if people don't like what the scriptures say, it's not that they don't like us. They don't like the Bible.
Yes.
If they defend themselves from what the scripture says, it's not me that they have a problem with. You got a problem with the Bible, you have a problem with God.
Yeah.
If God says that disciples have to go make disciples and baptize them, and you haven't been made into a disciple, but you got baptized, and you're putting up a front, you're not getting mad at me, you're getting mad at the scriptures.
Yeah.
God said to do this. Jesus said to do this. And we see people might get mad. People might get angry at what we teach from the scriptures. People might not want to accept that the whole world is lost. That everyone has fallen short of the glory of God. Everyone. That's what the Bible teaches in Romans. Everyone's fallen short. That you can't be born a Christian. Even in other faiths, if you actually read the Quran, people, you gotta decide to be a Muslim and do what the Quran says. No one can be born. You can be born into a Christian household.
Yeah.
It doesn't make you a Christian. Now, don't get me wrong. All babies are saved.
Oh yeah.
Jesus said, "Let the children come to me."
Yeah.
Right. All children, they can't think for themselves. They do stuff, but they don't have a conscience. Right. So they're saved. Right. They're saved. They may do simple things, but they don't understand. So they're fine. But it's those, it's adults.
Yes.
It's men and women that know right from wrong.
Yeah.
Right? And we just gotta give our whole heart to the scriptures.
Yeah.
When you see something in the Bible, you gotta just be quiet, you gotta shut up and do it.
Yeah.
Which brings me to my final point. Total obedience. Total obedience. When we are totally obedient to God, when we give our whole heart to God, God will move in such a powerful way. God will do things that you never thought could happen. You know, I think about our brother, Bradley Panda. And Bradley Panda was baptized about 2.5 years ago. And when Bradley decided, you know what? When Bradley decided to be totally obedient to God, when Bradley decided to give his whole heart to not give half of his heart, not hide anything, when he decided to give everything, he baptized Tracy. And they got married in the kingdom of God, amen. And they have a beautiful daughter named Chloe. But if the man of God didn't give his whole heart, I don't know if you guys would be together right now.
Yeah.
But it takes a lot of faith to give everything. You know, I think about our brother, Ola Kokoi, who was in total obedience when he found out his interest was mutual. And he gave his whole heart to Denise. Amen. And I just found this out. And in 1 year, they dated, got married, and had children. Oh, he gave his whole heart. Had twins. You know, I think about myself. When I gave my whole heart to my wife, after I had pulled back my close to not winning the woman of my dreams.
Yeah.
I was close to losing that relationship. But I made the decision, you know, I gotta give her my whole heart.
Yeah.
And that's what we're gonna be with God.
Yeah.
Maybe you're in this room right now and you realize you're just far away from God. Maybe you're like, man, my relationship with God isn't where it needs to be. Isn't where I want it to be. Well, you can make a decision today to give your whole heart.
Yes.
Let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 18. We'll bring it for a close. We're going to look at David. David is such a mighty man of God. 1 Samuel chapter 18. And in verse 6, so David has killed Goliath, right? He slayed Goliath, he cut his head off, he's got Goliath's head in his hand, and he's speaking to Saul. And Saul's like, man, who is that guy? He's gotta be my armor bearer. So David is an armor bearer to Saul, and he plays the lyre. And in verse 6, It says, when the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the women came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing, with joyful songs and with tambourines and lyres. As they danced, they sang, Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands. Verse 8, Saul was very angry. He got bitter. He got jealous, envious. Saul was very angry. His refrain displeased him greatly. They have credited David with tens of thousands, he thought. But me, with only thousands? Saul wasn't happy with just killing thousands. You know what a thousand, thousands of people are? That's like the Wembley Stadium. Thousands of people. I'll be a thousand. Okay, amen. I'll take that. I'm good with thousands. But he was so envious. He just wanted to be better than everyone else. It said that Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. They have credited David with 10,000s. He thought, but with me only thousands. What more can he get but the king? And from that time on, Saul kept a close eye on David. Is there someone that you're keeping a close, critical eye on? You know when I can have a critical eye. You know when you have a critical eye. When you see someone's got a nice haircut, you're like, they didn't shave their hair. or someone's shaved bald.
Oh yeah.
And you're like, they got a whisker back here. You can be critical about that, but you can be critical spiritually.
Yes.
That brother's always standing up there. Song me. Why can't I song me? And you don't tell anyone that you want to song me. Let's go back to the scripture. Verse 10. The next day, an evil spirit from God came forcefully on Saul. He was prophesying in his house while David was playing the lyre, as he usually did. Saul had a spear in his hand. So Saul, he's prophesying. He's probably rocking back and forth. Got a spear in his hand. An evil spirit is inside of him. And in verse 11, it says, and he hurled it, saying to himself, I will pin David to the wall. But David eluded him twice. So Saul's sitting there saying some words, probably doing some false doctrine, speaking in tongues and stuff like that, because the evil spirit is in him. And then he chucks the spear at David. Why? Because the spirit isn't leaving Saul. The spirit stops leaving Saul. You know, discipling can stop working in your life when you're not giving your whole words. Again, you may be compliant to discipling, you may agree, but you gotta give your whole heart to discipling, or you're not gonna change. And it said David eluded him twice. So that means Saul threw two spears at him, trying to kill David. Let's see what happened next. Verse 12. Saul was afraid of David. You see, it said Saul was afraid of David, not David afraid of Saul. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David, but had departed from Saul. Verse 13. So he sent David away from him and gave him command over thousands. And David led troops in the campaign. And everything he did, he had great success because the Lord was with him. When Saul saw how successful he was afraid. But all Israel and Judah loved David because he led them in their campaigns, and the church said, amen. We gotta see this. Saul threw spears at David to kill him. And David didn't even leave. He dodged, but he stood there. Why? kill David. And David gives his whole heart to the man that God put in his life. Let's go to chapter 19. Verse 1. Saul told his son Jonathan and all the attendants to kill David. David is now has left Saul's presence and is fighting for Saul. And now Saul's like, nah, I can't take this. And he gets his army to attack and kill David. And he gets his son to do it as well. Saul told his son and all the attendants to kill David. But Jonathan had taken a great liking to David and warned him. My father Saul is looking for a chance to kill you. Be on your guard tomorrow morning. Go into hiding and stay there. I will go out and stand with my father in the field where you are. I will speak to him about you and will tell you what I find out. Jonathan spoke well of David to Saul, his father, and said to him, let not the king do wrong to his servant David. He has not wronged you, and what he has done has benefited you greatly. He took his life in his hands when he killed the Philistine. The Lord won a great victory for all Israel, and you saw it and were glad. Why then would you do wrong to an innocent man like David? By killing him for no reason. So listen to Jonathan and took this oath. As surely as the Lord lives, David will not be put to death. So Jonathan called David and told him the whole conversation. So Jonathan called David, told him the whole conversation. He brought him to Saul, and David was with Saul as before, and the church said, amen. David was in total obedience to Saul. Saul tried to throw spears at him, trying to kill him. Then after that, Saul sent his men to kill David. So three times, Saul has tried to kill David. And obviously Jonathan comes in and he helps out right there. And then in verse 7, at the end it says, he brought David to Saul, and David was with Saul as again and again and again. David gave his whole heart to Saul. How much more us? I mean, for the disciples, has any disciple tried to kill you?
No.
No. Let me ask again. Has any disciple tried to physically kill you? Not physically kill you. I hope not. I mean, please tell me if someone has. But no. I've never heard of a disciple physically trying to kill another disciple. We don't do that. Happened in the Bible with Saul and David. But David was still in total obedience to Saul. It said that David was with Saul like nothing had happened. But yet we get upset. We get upset when a brother says, hey bro, you need to smell it. And we get ticked off. We get upset. We get upset when a brother says, hey, you're not doing well spiritually. You need to be in a brother's household. And we feel like we're being killed. We feel like people are throwing spears at us. No, no, no. David had spears thrown at us. We have spiritual well-being being thrown at us to help us in our spirit. If David did it, how much more us? What was David known as? Man after God's own heart. Do you guys want to be people after God's own heart? You got to imitate David. I'm not going to kill anyone. The story is just so funny. We're not going to kill each other. We're going to try our best to help each other to get to the place where God wants us to.
Amen.
Do you give your whole heart to the man or woman? person that reached out to you, that person that shared their faith with you, that person that asked you to study the Bible, that person that invited you out to church, that person that mentors you, are you willing to give your whole heart to that person?
Yes.
Come on. I challenge you guys to give your whole heart. I challenge you to go up to your disciple. Go up to that man. Go up to that woman that you know, you see that God has been using that person to work in your life. Go up to that person and just get over. Just be like, I want to give you my whole heart. I challenge you to do that. Because once you say it, you better do it. Amen? Give your whole heart to God. Give your whole heart to the kingdom. Give your whole heart to people who are studying the Bible, to people who want to become disciples. And the last challenge is for everyone just to pick a brother and a sister in the church. Make a decision to be like, okay, I'm going to give my whole heart to that individual. Amen?
Amen.
Can we give a whole heart, church?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Are you going to be totally obedient?
Yes.
Give your whole heart?
Yes. Yes.
I don't believe you.
Yes.
Are you going to be totally obedient?